Hello aspirants, this is the video lecture on discussion about the paper 1 of the GS main 2019 brought to you by Shah's IAS Institute. So in this video lecture we are going to discuss about the history and culture questions asked in the GS main exam 2019. So here we are trying to give you certain pointers that you should have attempted this question and how your model answer should have been. Obviously you can enrich and enhance your answers further by adding your own pointers and information using the fruitful sources, adding information to these answers. Okay, so there were approximately 6 questions on history and art and culture, in which 3 questions were of 10 marks, in which you were supposed to write your answers in 150 words, and 3 questions were of 15 marks, which needs to be written in 250 words each. So making the entire history and culture section of this GS1 paper of 75 marks, right? So now we're going to deal with the very first question of this paper, that is this might not be in the chronological order, but you can see the questions. The first question was, many voices had strengthened and enriched the nationalist movement during the Gandhian phase. Elaborate. Okay, so here you were supposed to write that how the nationalist movement during the Gandhian phase was proceeded further and which enhanced the nationalist movement. So how all the sections of society and many voices contributed in the national movement and strengthening it. So the very first you can write about the contribution of involvement of peasants. Okay, so involvement of peasants were very important, which begins from Champaran. Obviously the Gandhian phase began from 1917 onwards, right? So Champaran is a very basic and first moment of Gandhian phase, right? So in this Champaran movement, the contribution of Rajkumar Shukla is very important. Now, after that, you can add the Kheda movement. Okay. Again, in the Kheda movement, peasant satyagraha was very important, in which the contribution of Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, N.M. Joshi and the other leaders is very important and prominent to enriching the nationalist movement. Okay. Further, emergence of local leaders during the non-cooperation movement, that is the phase of 1920 to 22. Okay, so this led coming forward of every sections of society. So what is Quit India movement then? A Quit India movement, can also be called as August movement, was a movement launched at the Bombay session. So the Quit India movement is a movement which can also be called as August movement, was a movement launched at the Bombay session of All India Congress Committee by Mahatma Gandhi on 8th August 1942 during the World War II, demanding an end to the British rule of India. So you can have the idea that it was a precursor, and not a precursor, but it was very much needed for strengthening and giving the final phase to the nationalist movement during the Gandhian phase. Okay. Further, you can enhance your answer if you think some more information can be added to this answer. So you can do that by enriching your answer through various sources. Okay. Okay. Now moving forward to the next question, that is, assess the role of British imperial power in complicating the process of transfer of power during the 1940s. Obviously, you know that Britishers were not very much interested to handling the power to Indian people, because they were not interested. Why? Why is it so? Because it may snatch away their power to rule the entire Indian continent and impending their political power and ruining their economic gains from Indian subcontinent. Okay, so what all aspects which led to complicating the process of transfer of power during the 1940s, where August offer 1940s, Crisp mission 1942, British cabinet mission to India, announcement and formation of interim government at the center, proclamation of S.C. Rose to form the provincial government of Free India, general election of 1945, and Wewell plan can be the pointers in your answer, could have been the pointers in your answer. To better answer this question, these pointers were very much needed. Okay. So now moving further to the next question. Yes. Explain how the foundation of modern world were led by American and French Revolution. Okay. So obviously you might be aware what is American and what is French Revolution, right? So American Revolution, basically America have been one of colonist country of Britain, right? So the colonial rule also was So the suppression of colonial rule also left Americans to overthrow the British imperialism, which led their freedom struggle and further enhancing and making them establish a civil society, which is the base of today's modern world, right? So what all things were needed at that time when America was struggling their independence from British rule, right? So American Revolution, in which you can write about the North American colonies fought for their independence, okay? A step from autocracy to democracy, okay? Right concept of revolution, right of people to overthrow the oppressive government that was reinformed by Americans, okay? So later they made some political experiments like introduction of fundamental rights and all. American Revolution helped inspired French Revolution. This is the very important part of American Revolution. Later adoption of written constitution, okay? Abolition of hereditary kinship, hereditary feudal aristocracy, okay? Establishment of system of separation of power, checks and balances. So these are the very basic features which are used in today's modern world. In those features, today's various big economies are established. Principle of no taxation without representation. Now, French Revolution, it presented people with the idea of revolutionary change instead of evolutionary change. So they did not evolve, but they revolved all those things which were present at that time. You might be knowing about the nobility, the serfdom, right? So the ideas of liberty, democratic right came into being during the French Revolution, okay? All around the world, colonized people began to revolutionize many movements to establish a sovereign nation and state of their own. Okay, so these could have been the crux of your answer. Moving forward to the next question. Highlight the Central Asian and Greco-Bactrian elements in the Gandhara army. Okay. So you know that Buddhism and Jainism is very favorite part of UPSC exams each and every year, not just in mains but also in prelims. There are the questions from this Buddhism and Jainism part, right? So you can't just be you can't expect UPSC to put certain questions on Buddhism and Jainism in exams. So you should always be ready with these two parts of art and culture anytime which UPSC might ask you. Okay. So the question was, highlight the Central Asian and Greco-Bactrian elements in the Gandhara art. Right? So you were supposed to write about the Gandhara art basically. What is the basic features of Gandhara art and what all the features that have been derived from Central Asian and Greco-Bactrian element in the Gandhara art. So basically, what is Gandhara art? Gandhara art is a style of Buddhist visual art that developed in what is now northwestern Pakistan and eastern Afghanistan between 1st century BCE and the 7th century CE. Okay. So what all features were needed to highlight the Central Asian and Greco-Bactrian elements in the Gandhara art? That is the use of grey sandstone. Example, Banyan Buddha, that is in Rajasthan. Okay. So this is the example of using grey sandstone, right? Second, Gandhara images, anatomical accuracy, spatial depth, and foreshortening. Okay. Greek and Roman influence of Gandhara art that may come in your Central Asian part. Depiction of man god inspired from Greek mythology. Next, stucco plaster, commonly observed monastic and cult buildings. So in their monastic and cult buildings, the stucco plaster have been used very efficiently. Artistic interpretation of Buddha images, like through Roman motifs. Okay. Then artistic techniques, anthropomorphic tradition, that is depiction of Buddha in humanistic feature, his dresses like halo and all, which is behind Buddha, Greek god as protector, Vajrapani, Greek and architectural influence, artistic beauty, intellectual affinity. These could have been the features of Central Asian and Greco-Bactrian elements of Gandhara art. Okay. Moving forward to the next question. The 1857 uprising was the culmination of recurrent big and small local rebellions that had occurred in the preceding 100 years of British rule elucidate. So obviously you know nothing happens immediately. It takes time for big things to occur, right? So there were some precursors. You can say that there were some precursors for the uprising of 1857. What all are those precursors? We will see those precursors one by one. Okay. So Dhil uprising, which was led by economic distress, famine and misgovernment. Okay. Next, Ramosi uprising under the leadership of Umaji Naik, right? Bhil uprising, Ramosi uprising, revolt of Savantwadi. Okay. Revolt of Raja of Vijayanagaram, revolt of Poligas, which was in Odisha at that period, the Wahhabi movement, and the Sipoy Mutiny. Okay, so these pointers should have been in your answer to effectively answer this question. Okay, now the last question was, so the last question dealt with examining the linkages between 19th century's Indian Renaissance and the emergence of national identity. So basically it is asking about what happened during the 19th century, that is Indian Renaissance, which had an influence in the emergence of national identity. So you have to write here, you are supposed to write about the Indian Renaissance happened at that period. Okay, so Indian Renaissance, a period of transition in values, transformation in social sensibilities, and rebirth in the cultural creativity. Obviously many things emerged during that period in various areas. Okay, upsurge of creative energy, works of masters in paintings, sculptures, literature, music, okay, various reform movements, that is social, political and religious movement, contributed in the emergence of national identity, okay, what all movement can come in social, political and religious, like back to Vedas, which was a slogan given by Vivekananda, and Dayananda Saraswati advocated for the Dayananda Saraswati advocated for moving back to Vedas, okay, social and religious movement may include your Shuddhi movement and other movements, okay. Birth of middle class intelligentsia. So there were a lot of people who emerged as an intelligent beings at that moment, which was very much needed for the strengthening of national identity, emergence of new literature, various ideological differences, role of press for the effective propaganda, like how various Hindi, not just Hindi, in vernacular languages, various newspapers, journals have been introduced at that period of time, which led the emergence and strengthening of national identity. Like you can give the example of Bal Shastri Jambekar's newspaper and Lokman Tilak's newspaper and various others. Okay, role of some of the leaders, that is Dayananda Saraswati, Vivekananda, Dorazio. So you can write about them. And then poetic influence of Bankim Chandra Chatterjee, his Anand Math and Vande Mataram. They have a very strong influence at that period on the masses. Okay, works of Orientalists also contributed in the recognition of national identity. So not just Indian only, but the Orientalists and some of the English people also contributed in the recognition of national identity. So they also promoted our emergence of national identity. Okay, so these could have been your pointers for the writing the answer. Okay.